Okay, assalamualaikum and good morning to respected professors, associate professors, doctors, our esteemed VIPs, Associate Prof. Dr. Rafidah, Head of Biomedical Imaging Department of University Science Malaysia, and Prof. Haristanto, Head of Physics and Mathematics Department of University of Diponegoro, respected participants, including clinicians, medical physicists, lecturers, healthcare practitioners, and students from around the world. We extend a cordial welcome to the second IPPT-USM-UNDIP joint webinar, and this event signifies our second collaborative initiative between the Department of Biomedical Imaging and Liver Malignancies Research Program at Institut Perubatan dan Pergigian Termaju USM and Department of Physics, Faculty of Science and Mathematics of University of Diponegoro, Indonesia. The theme of today's webinar is Digital Image Processing in Radiology and Nuclear Medicine Practice that aims to explore the potential of digital image processing in healthcare, emphasizing its substantial influence on the realms of radiology and nuclear medicine. We thank our distinguished speakers from both universities who will be sharing their perspectives on how these techniques are transforming the healthcare landscape. Before we begin, I invite Dr. Muhammad Firdaus Mat Pauzi for a doa recital.
I would like to welcome and greet all of you today with the greeting of Islam, the word be best from Almighty God Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, blessing, and mercy of Allah be with all of you today. We begin our prayer by reciting Umm al-Kitab al-Fatiha. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم يا الله praise be to God the Lord of the world peace and blessing be upon our Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم and his companions and for those who followed his example till judgment day اللهم يا الله On this blessed morning, in conjunction with second IPPT and UNDIP joint webinar, we beseech thee and grateful towards you in favor for all the infinite blessing to us, your humble servant, to live in safe and prosperous life. We seek your blessing for a flawless progress of this event from beginning till the end. We seek your guidance to steer clear of the event that would detrimental progress of this. Ya Hayyu Ya Qayyum. Please bless us with your tawfiq and hidayat. Please guide University Science Malaysia to greatness, peace, glory, and prosperity in this world and hereafter. Make us a responsible intellectual, granted us with a valuable knowledge that will be beneficial to mankind in order to gain your mardatillah. Make us a righteous servant that followed your commands and neglect the sinful act. Please forgive us for our wrongdoing. Ya Munzil al-Barakat, bestow peace to our beloved country Malaysia. Preserve us from any threat, neither man-made nor natural disaster. And to you, Ya Allah, we ask for security and prosperity upon us, upon our leaders and our country Malaysia. Bestow patience in us in order to face the challenges from you. Please accept our deeds and please reward us accordingly. Rabbana alayka tawakkalna wa ilayka anabna wa ilayka al-masir. اللهم عز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم انصر إخواننا المسلمين والمجاهدين في فلسطين اللهم ثبت إيمانهم وأنزل السكينة في قلوبهم وحدد صفوفهم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين والحمد لله رب العالمين Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Firdaus. We shall now commence our program with a welcome address from the Deputy Director of Clinical Services of USM Medical Center. I invite Associate Professor Dr. Nur Khairiyah A. Karim to the mic.
Assalamualaikum and very good morning to everyone, respected professors, associate professors, doctors, esteemed VIPs from both institutions, University of Diponegoro and also University Science Malaysia. and respected participants from around the world. A very warm welcome to the second IPPT-USM-UNDIP joint webinar with the theme Digital Image Processing in Radiology and Nuclear Medicine Practice. This marks our second collaborative effort between the Department of Biomedical Imaging at Institut Perubatan dan Pertikaian Termaju IPPT, University of Science Malaysia, and the Department of Physics, Faculty of Science and Mathematics, University of Diponegoro, UNDIP, Indonesia. The webinar aims to explore the potential of digital image processing in healthcare, highlighting its significant impact on the field of radiology and nuclear medicine. So our distinguished speakers will share their insights and how these techniques are revolutionizing healthcare. And throughout this webinar, we encourage active participation and let us collectively engage in a very vibrant exchange of ideas between both institutions. Finally, I want to convey my sincere appreciation to the program committees, and everyone who has dedicated their hard work to bring this event a reality. With that, I thank you and let the webinar commence. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you so much, Associate Prof. Dr. Khairia. Now it is an honor to hear a speech from the Dean of Faculty of Science and Mathematics of Diponegoro University, Professor Dr. Widowati.
Thank you very much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Excellency, Associate Professor Dr. Nur Khairia, Deputy Director Clinical Services Sustainable and Standard USM Medical Center Perham University Sains Malaysia. Honorable Professor Dr. Heri Sutanto as the Head of Physics Department Faculty of Sciences and Mathematics Diponegoro University. And also the honorable speakers from USM and UNDIP, Dr. Mohd Syahir Mansor, Dr. Choirul Anam. The Honorable Associate Professor Dr. Mohd Zahri Abdul Aziz. Honorable Program Coordinator Dr. Panji Triadaksha, Dr. Nur Diana Usman. All lecturer, researcher, and students from Physics Department Faculty of Sciences and Mathematics, Diponegoro University, also from other faculties, such as from Faculty of Medicine, Diponegoro University. All lecturer, researcher, and student from IPPT-USM, all respected participants of the second IPPT-USM-UNDIP joint webinar. First of all, I would like to welcome all of you to the second IPPT-USM-UNDIP joint webinar. Thank you for being here with us today. I would also express my sincere appreciation to the organizer of this event, both from Faculty of Science and Mathematics, Diponegoro University, and IPPT University Sains Malaysia. This joint webinar is the second joint webinar between UNDIP and USM. The theme of this interesting webinar is Image Processing for Radiology and Nuclear Medicine. I am very happy that this joint webinar is being held again. Previously, the first joint webinar between UNDIP and USM had been successfully held in April 2023. At this time, the webinar was attended by almost 300 participants, while for the second webinar, according to information from the committee, the registered participant was more than 330. Even registration was closed several days ago. I heard that there are many prospective participants who still want to register, but it has been closed. This indicates that the joint webinar between UNDIP and USM is very useful and interesting. From the committee information, this joint webinar is also attended not only by students and researchers from Faculty of Science and Mathematics, Diponegoro University, and IPPT, University Saint Malaysia, but also by professional clinical medical physics from various hospitals and other institutions in Indonesia and Malaysia. Again, thanks to everyone. I hope that joint webinar will continue to be held in the future. Even other activities such as research collaboration, student exchange, and others can also be carried out immediately. Alhamdulillah, the collaborative activities between UNDIP and USM have been carried out well. In December 2022, staff of Physics Department have visited the IPPT-USM. The staff who visited IPPT-USM were Professor Dr. Heri Sutanto, Dr. Choirul Anam, Dr. Eko Hidayanto, and Zainal Arifin, Master of Science. Previously, Dr. Nordiana Osma, staff from IPPT-USM, had given a public lecture on CT dosimetry in the middle of last year in Physics Department, Faculty of Science and Mathematics, Diponegoro University. And of course, the first joint webinar was successful. I hope that the Memorandum of Understanding can also be signed by UNDIP and USM soon. We realize that both institutions have their own strengths and weaknesses. By strong collaboration between both institutions, the shortcoming of each can be covered by the others. Again, I hope that in the future, the collaboration between UNDIP and USM will be even stronger. I also heard that staff from IPPT-USM are planning to visit Diponegoro University, Indonesia. We will welcome you anytime. Our doors will be always open to all of you. Thank you very much for your kind attention. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam, and thank you so much, Professor Dr. Widowati. Now, without further delay, I shall introduce to you the moderator of the day, Associate Professor Dr. Muhammad Zahri Abdul Aziz. Just a bit about Dr. Zahri. He currently serves as an Associate Professor at University Science Malaysia, where he is also a clinical physicist. His academic journey includes a bachelor's degree in medical radiation, a master's in medical physics, and a PhD in medical radiation physics. And beyond teaching, Dr. Zahri is a prolific researcher, publishing research articles and books, and notably, he co-authored a book for radiologist candidates preparing for FRCR examination. Dr. Zahri's research focuses on innovative brachytherapy techniques, particularly for anatomical sites like tongue, liver, prostate, and head and neck. He's a pioneer in the hybrid brachytherapy, followed by intensity-modulated radiotherapy hybrid technique for tongue cancer, emphasizing post-treatment functionality. He also showed great leadership in his role as Deputy Chairman of Malaysian Brachytherapy Society, MBS. Now, I shall invite Dr. Muhammad Zahri to the mic.
Assalamualaikum. Thank you, Aimi. Assalamualaikum. Selamat pagi, Malaysia, Indonesia, USM and UNDIP. Very warm welcome to all guests joining us for this exciting and informative webinar. And your attendance here means a lot, and we are genuinely grateful for your participation. And ladies and gentlemen, so without further ado, I would like to introduce our first speaker, Dr. Muhammad Syahir Mansor from IPPT, University Science Malaysia. Okay. He was born in Penang, Malaysia, and has an impressive educational background. He holds a bachelor degree in medical radiation science from University Science Malaysia, and a master's degree in the same field, specializing in nuclear medicine physics. During his academic journey, he was awarded a fellowship program from USM and the Ministry of Higher Education of Malaysia. And then this program allowed him to work at the Department of Radiology and Nuclear Medicine at the Vrije Universiteit Medical Center, VUMC, in Amsterdam, Netherlands. And following to that, he worked as a postdoctoral research associate at the Mellencourt Institute of Radiology, Washington University in San Luis, USA. He also had an expertise in PET quantification, kinetic analysis, internal dosimetry, particularly in field of neurology, oncology, and cardiology. He is also passionate about integrating artificial intelligence into nuclear medicine imaging and dosimetry. And his goal is to foster collaboration among the different nuclear medicine centers worldwide for quantitative study in this area. And we are excited to have Dr. Syahir here to share his extensive knowledge and experience. And please join me in welcoming him in the stage. And the floor is yours, Dr. Syahir.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Zahri. I will share my screen now. So, the moderator, can you see the screen? I think.
Yes, of course.
Okay, all right. So, assalamualaikum and a very good morning to participants from Indonesia, from Malaysia. So, first of all, I would like to thank the organizer and also all those participants who spend their weekend time for this webinar. Okay. Without further ado, I would like to go further with our agenda. So today I would like to discuss on the towards PET-CT precision in oncology and neurology application. So I am Syahir from IPPT. So for the outline of this talk, there will be an introduction to PET. Next will be the clinical use of PET, a bit on the repeatability, the term of repeatability, the source of error in PET, and then we go further for the precision or one of the repeatability studies, and my final thought on these particular topics. So for the introduction, as we know that medical imaging comprises a broad range of modalities, right? So it's suits the purpose of from the anatomical function, giving a function of for anatomical, and also giving the function of physiological at the right hand side of the screen. As you can see, there's a pointer. So we have the purely anatomical structure information that gave from X-ray and CT, while we have on the right hand side, we have the pure physiological function given by the PET. A part of that, we also have a SPECT, but the quantification is a little less accurate compared to the PET. We also have MRI, optical imaging, ultrasound, and also scintigraphy. This is a planar scintigraphy. So for the quick introduction, what is PET actually? PET is the positron emission tomography from its name. If you have any radionuclide that has a rich proton radionuclide, the instability tend to transform the proton into neutron. So the outcome of the transformation, there will be an ejection of positron. As we can see here, the electron plus. So it has the same mass, but different in terms of the charge. When positron interacted with the electron within our body, automatically we have the inhalation pair of inhalation photon, which carries the energy of 511 keV on each photon. So you can imagine if we have this type of radionuclide, we tag with, in this case, is the FDG. This is the molecular structure of FDG. We tag on the F18, and then we inject it to the patient or to the subject. We manage to basically detect in 360 degree of 511 keV photons. And then from there, we measure the projection for each photon towards the detector, and then stores into the sinogram form. From here, we can do reconstruction to basically get back those spatial distribution of the radionuclide within the body. For in this case, you can see this is a brain scan with a pair of inhalation photon detected. So after we do reconstruction, we can go further for the analysis. As you can see here, we can do semi-quantitative, we can do quantitative, we even can determine how fast or how slow any particular radiopharmaceutical or drugs moving within the body. For in case of the brain, how long it will take from the blood transfer into the brain. So this kind of information we can get from the PET, as long as we have enough data for that. As you can see here, this is the cross-sectional of the image of the body. You can see it's clearly defined: a spine uptake, a lung with less uptake, liver will be the major organ for the metabolism, right? And then we have a spleen, kidney, bowel, and also bladder. So any organs or region that you are interested to, you can get information from here. So a bit on the clinical use of PET. You can see here PET can be used for cancer staging, tumor response assessment, for the cancer staging, for a new patient that has been suspected with cancer, we can do PET in order to get the clear or the whole picture of the stage of the cancer within those particular subject or patient. And also we also can do the tumor response assessment, whereby we have a cancer patient who went through any treatment, brachytherapy treatment or chemotherapy, then we can see how the tumor responds towards the treatment using the PET. We also have the PET for neurology, cardiology, thyroid, and also infection and inflammation. So basically, we have a very wide variety of clinical use for the patient, basically. So basically, for each clinical use, we have a dedicated radiopharmaceutical. The most widely used is the, as I mentioned just now, F18 glucose. So a bit on the repeatability, I have a question towards everybody. So if we have a subject, right, one particular subject who is going through the first PET scan, right, after we do the acquisition, and then we do all those analysis, and then we get the result. And then the patient or the subject going through maybe the treatment, or just wait for another 3 or 6 months to see the progress, and then do the same PET scan again on the session 2. So the question is, how can you sure that the thing that you measured here is the changes, if you can see the changes, how sure you are that the changes came from any treatment or any disease progress that are coming from the disease itself? So here is the main thing that we have to think, that both session, you have to understand that you have to very clear that both session has the same accuracy and a precision between those scans. So here I want to highlight the concept of a precision and also the accuracy. As you can see here, just imagine you have two or multiple numbers of count or scans. You wanted to have high accuracy, high precision, right? Because PET is considered very accurate, but the repeatability or the precision will sometimes a problem in terms of PET. As you can see here, this is very low accuracy, low precision. The reproducibility is very low. Here, the good reproducibility, but they are biased towards some areas from the center. This is also not in a good, because it has a high uncertainty, high accuracy with low precision, right? So this is the most desirable data that we wanted from our PET. Okay. So previous study from the previous study, there are quite a lot of numbers that contributed the source of error in PET. So basically, we can see the repeatability or the precision within 10 to 15%. So this is where we wanted our data to have, but the less, there will be a better in terms of the precision. So those lack of precision, maybe it can due to the inaccuracy of administering activity, the variability in patient preparation. This is also one of the main problem in a clinical practice, where different patient has different in terms of their blood glucose level, but at the moment we have a certain threshold for that. And image noise due to variability in scan statistics. So this is also one of the main problem, because different PET scanner has a different in terms of the noise characteristics, the sensitivity, and so on. So this might be also a source of error in terms of precision in PET CT. So we have to closely monitor into each particular point, so that you can sure that at the end of the day, your PET scan actually giving the high accuracy, high precision data or measurement. So we dive into a bit on the how we quantify. Okay, if we have a PET data, and then we have cardiac metastasis here, I think if we take the cross sectional of this part of the body, you can see here, this is the transaxial part of the thorax. So if you like draw the whole volume of interest within those particular tumor lesion, if we magnify that, actually it has a non-homogeneity within the particular lesion, right? Here we can see, if we take the whole volume of interest to be considered in, so we have the mean value or the average value. But if we have a max value, we just take the most highest pixel or voxel within those lesion volume of interest. And then they introduce another one, will be the peak value. Peak value means that you have to consider to have a 1 millimeter or 2 millimeter sphere. So anything within those sphere, the center of the sphere will be the maximum value. So there will be a weightage of maximum within those particular sphere. So you average all those value, and then you get the peak. So basically, you have to be considerate, because sometimes you have an old PET CT which has not that good in terms of the sensitivity, and now we have a really very sensitive, very accurate PET CT. So these factors, that will be one of the factors that will hamper the way of we get the data. For instance, if we have a very high noise data, this value, as you max or any max value, will be overshoot. So you will get a really bad in terms of the precision. You may get a good accuracy, but in terms of repeatability, you suffer a lot from this. So to avoid this, that's why they introduce the peak, so that will mitigate the problem within the high noise PET system. So this is the one of the slide from EARL committee in under the EANM, European Nuclear Medicine Society. So they already have a clear structure that how much deviation of the data from your PET can be. So basically, as you can see here, even though when you do a phantom scan or any scans, the higher the SUV are not necessarily better, right? You can see here, it's tend to overshoot. So this is the problem whereby if you have some sort of lag in terms of the repeatability, you will get this kind of overshoot within the data. So for the study design, I would like to share one of the study design that we did. So we have now we are focusing on the oncological and also neurological area. So for the phantom preparation, so we fill in the F18 source within this particular compartment. So for the image quality phantom studies, we use 3 to 30 kilobecquerel to ml ratio. So it gives us approximately 1 to 10 background to target ratio. On the other hand, we use 100 kilobecquerel of concentration of F18 for the brain phantom. So for the PET scan acquisition, we use both body mode for the IQ phantom, and then the brain mode for the brain phantom. So for the first acquisition, for the IQ phantom, we just acquire the data for 120 minutes in a stationary position, and then we, after that, we can remain into any duration or any particular frame that you needed after that. So for the second one is the short framing repositioning. This basically replicate when you have a patient doing the scan, and then you try to randomize the position of the patient so that you basically can see after this how far is the difference between the first scan and the second scan if we have a randomized positioning of the patient or subject for the PET scan. And then for the image processing, we have the for Philips system and also for Siemens system, both we apply the PSF or resolution modeling, and both also has the time of flight applied as well. So for the metric, we use the recovery coefficient, which is the activity within those phantom divided by the true activity from the well counter. So this is we want to see the accuracy, and also after this we can see the precision in term of the data. So we can see when we after we do the processing, we basically delineate whatever lesion that we have here. So you have a multiple diameter of lesion, and then for the brain you have a gray and white matter. So for the gray matter, this is a parietal, caudate, putamen, and also a temporal region of the phantom. And then for the white matter, we can consider within those internal structure and also the external structure of the white matter region. So when after we finished with the data acquisition, data reconstruction, and also processing, as you can see here, this is from the Philips Ingenuity, and this is from the Siemens Biograph. So this is the voxel value of those. As you can see here, this is for the 5 minute frame duration. So stationary will be the phantom or the subject maybe in a standard stationary form, but for the reposition, we do randomize placing of the phantom within the country. So you can see here in the first system, there will be an overshoot, right? So this is the expected value to be had. Okay, if we apply the point spread function, there will be an overshoot here in the Philip Ingenuity system. And for the Siemens Biograph system, you have some sort of stable in terms of value. You can see the most suffered metric will be the max, of course, because you are only considering one voxel of the from the pad. You can see a mean will give you some sort of a good agreement, but this is the best. The peak will be the best because as you can see here, the precision is quite broad here, right? And then we have a better in terms of the precision after we reach the 17 millimeter of diameter of the lesion or sphere. So you can see how both system behaves, right? They have different in terms of the characteristics. So that's why you have to know the system, the data that you are going to use later for the clinical purpose. So this is effect of so here you can see if we have a smaller in terms of voxel size, it's even hampering the max value because of the count per pixel. Because if you have a more voxel, but you have a limited in terms of number of counts, so you have suffering in terms of count per pixel problem here. You can see the max suffers a lot. Peak, you can see a steady in terms of the recovery coefficient, but mean also gives a good in terms of this due to the variance in terms of the voxel size. So what happened when we shorten down the frame duration? This is the frame duration for 2 minute frame. As you can see, the variation or the precision even worse for each individual sphere, right? You can see also in within those even though you have another system, then you can see how deviate your data from the real or accurate one. this is just a sharing in terms of the brain part, because as you can see previously, the oncological area will suffer the most, but for the brain studies, there will be not much a problem. As you can see, you can rely on the PET brain data, even though you have multiple randomized scan. You can see the very high reproducibility of the number of recovery coefficient. As you can see, we can't get sort of actual value due to the area of the brain, because for the brain studies we use quite a huge in terms of the area of interest. So you can see the gray matter and also the white matter both didn't suffer any precision error or precision problem within this particular area. So my final thought will be, of course, the precision, as you can see just now, dependence, very dependent on scan statistic. If you change the duration, of course, your noise characteristic will be changed, and then and then at the end of the day, the quantification will be a bit unprecise, or the accuracy is there but unprecise in terms of the precision. So how you analyze the data also need to be considered as well. Part of that, there will be a problem in terms of reconstruction. So a different vendor gives you a different strategy, how they manage to tune down the noise characteristic of the system. So current findings extend the effect of so you can see the randomized positioning impacting the longitudinal. If you have a scan and rescan in terms of oncology, and also less in terms of the brain. Systemic displacement. So basically, we have a limitation here because of we do the randomized. But if you have a systematic displacement after this, then we can see how is the magnitude of the changes versus the magnitude of displacement that we introduce in. So the precision still challenging even with a more advanced or modern PET system nowadays. So you can see the data still giving unreliable, as long as you set something such as what have been done in Europe. They have the EARL certification, so that everybody or every center, they have to follow a very strict SOP in doing a PET scan. So finally, there will be introduction of machine learning and deep learning in the future for the PET data. So this will help to mitigate or to increase the precision of the PET system, not only for oncology, also for other scan as well. So with that, I would like to finish my session. Thank you very much for your attention. Assalamualaikum. If you have anything, then maybe you can email me directly if you have to know more regarding these topics. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Syahir, for an insightful presentation. And if you have any question to ask him, please you can use the chat box, and I will read the question after the second presentation. And yeah, kamu juga bisa aja nanya dalam bahasa Indonesia sekiranya perlu, ya. Enggak apa-apa. Okay, now we are excited to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Choirul Anam from the Ponorogo University, UNDIP. Briefly about himself, in 2018, he earned his PhD from Bandung Institute of Technology, IPB. Before that, he obtained his master's degree from University of Indonesia, UI, in 2010, and bachelor's degree in physics from the Ponorogo University, UNDIP, in 2001. Dr. Anam research has taken him around the world. He conducted research on CT dosimetry at Kyushu University in 2016. His research interests includes medical image reconstruction, processing, and dosimetry for diagnostic radiology, especially in CT scan. He authored over 180 papers and has been the first author for more than 50 in peer-reviewed first pass tickets. Dr. Anam is also a respected reviewer for reputable medical physics journal and holds position on the editorial board for Journal of Medical Physics and Biophysics, JMPB, and the Journal of Physics and its Application, JPA. His exceptional work has earned him numerous awards and recognition, including the Best Medical Imaging Physics Article in 2016 and the CPOM Young Leader Awards in 2019. Furthermore, Dr. Anam is a software developer, creating valuable tools such as IndoCity and IndoQCity, both available for download at www.indosect.com. We are honored to have Dr. Choirul Anam here today to share his knowledge and experience. Please join me in welcoming him to our virtual stage. Dr. Anam, we look forward for your insight.
Thank you, Dr. Zahri. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. I will share my presentation. Can you see my PPT?
Yes.
Okay. My talk is about image processing on CT images for automatic image quality assessment. And this is the contents of my presentation. Only three. I will explain about the fundamental of image processing. And then we move to the second one on the parameters of CT image quality. And because the limited time, I only will share some examples of automatic assessment of CT image quality. Maybe we can discuss more by email or by another time. Okay. Now I will discuss about the image and the pixel. What is the image? Image is the visual representation of something. It can be object, body, person, and so on. And the image is consisted from the picture element. The picture element is the pixel. So the pixel element, there are three things important in the pixel: the pixel number, pixel size, and pixel depth. In the CT images, the pixel number will be around the 500, but for the high resolution CT, the number of pixel can be more than 1000. Okay. But for the standard CT, it's around the 100. And the pixel size lead to the spatial resolution. And the pixel size depend on the FOV, field of view. You can see here, if the field of view is large, then the pixel size will be also large. We can see here, for example, if the field of view are about 230, the pixel size will be around 0.45. And if we have the larger field of view, for example, 400, for example, then the pixel size will be larger. And beside the pixel number and pixel size, the pixel depth is also important. The pixel depth represent the gray level. There are many depth of the pixel. For example, the N3 for the 8-bit, the N8 for the 256-bit, and for CT, the N will be more than 13. So the gray level is from 0 or from minus 1000 to more than 4000, like that. And on CT, what pixel represent? You can see here the the pixel is represent to the linear attenuation from the X-ray passing to the patient like this. So the image of the CT is actually the mapping of the linear attenuation coefficient. And because the linear attenuation coefficient is very wide, so and not calibrated, so the linear attenuation is calibrated with the water using this formula and multiply by the 1000. So the pixel value in the CT is the standardized with the water, and the name of the pixel is the Hans using the Hansfield unit. The Hansfield unit is very wide from the CT, from minus 1000 to around 4000. Okay, like this. The minus 1000 is from air, and more than 1000 plus 1000 is for the dense bone, like that. So because the our eye only see around the 200 gray level, so if we want to see the CT image with wider contrast, so we use the window level, window setting. There are two parameters for the windowing technique, is window width and window level, window width and window level. This is the example, the same CT images display with the three different window setting. This one is for the lung window, this one for the bone window, and this one for the maybe soft tissue window. So the pixel values not change, but also the appearance will change like this. So we can see the image with the more contrast like that. Okay, and then we move to the image processing. There are another many terms in the image processing. The first one is the image formation, image processing, image analysis, computer graphics, computer vision, and visualization. What are the difference between these terms? The image formation meaning that the input is object and the output is image, just like imaging using CT or MRI or PET scan and so on. This is the image formation. And how is the image processing? The image processing is the process which the input is image and the output is image with another type, with another looking like this. For example, edge detection, for example, with image with lower noise, or the image with the higher spatial resolution. This all is the image processing. While the image analysis is the input is image and the output is features. This is the image analysis. The input is the object and the output is values. This is the image analysis. And the inverse of the image analysis is computer graphic, meaning that the input is number, but the output is image. This is the computer graphics. And the computer vision, the input is image, and the output is interpretation. For example, the cancer staging, and so on. This is the computer vision. And the visualization is the input is image, and the output is representation or image with another types. So if we say the image processing, sometimes we meaning that not only image processing, but image processing with addition of the image analysis like that. Okay. So in this presentation, I said the image processing, but with the my intention, not only in the image processing, but also the image analysis. Okay, like that. The image analysis and image processing have so many application in all aspect of life, in the medicine, in the industry, environment, culture, television, education, security, and so on. In this today, we will talk about the image processing for the medical image processing, especially from the CT for me, and Dr. Zahri has spoken about this PET scan. Okay, and actually, so many operations in the image processing and also image analysis. And today we will only talk a little about it, about the segmentation, morphological operation, geometrical transformation, convolution and deconvolution, Fourier transformation, soft transformation, filtering, and so on. There's still so many operation in the image analysis and image processing. Okay. And now, the first we will talk about the segmentation. What is the segmentation? The segmentation is the division of the image into discrete region. Just like this, this is the image containing the patient image and background. So in the segmentation, we will divide this image into background and the image of the patient, like this. This called as the segmentation. Or for example, the background is the soft tissue and the target organ may be the tumor or cancer. This is also the segmentation. There are so many techniques in the segmentation. For the very the simplest one is thresholding method, edge piece method, active contour, k-mean clustering, and so on. So many technique in the image segmentation. Then I will only talk about the thresholding method. The thresholding method is the selection of the region of interest by defining the intensity range. For example, in this occasion, I want to segment the image of the patient from its background. We know that the background is the air with the CT number around minus 1000. And the patient border is the skin with the pixel values maybe more than zero. So it is very simple for us to segment the image of the patient, maybe using the threshold value around minus 100, we can get the image like this. But if we want to get the fully image of the patient, we can see there is the hole within the patient. So sometimes the only using segmentation is not enough to segment the object of interest. So we need another technique to get the fully segmentation image. So in this occasion, for example, and after this, we detect the edge of the object within the patient. And after that, we label them one by one, and then we measure the areas all of the object, and we take the largest one, and the largest one is considered as the border of the patient. So using the segmentation with the additional techniques, we can get the border of the patient completely like this. So in some cases, only using threshold techniques is not enough at all. Okay, this is the segmentation. Another one is morphological operation. As I said before, that threshold only sometimes is not enough. We should have an additional technique to get our intention. one of them by using morphological operation, by using the dilation, erosion, opening, closing, and so on. And it is done by using the structuring element like this. We can using the circle shape or using the another shape with the different diameter and radius. We can choose the structuring element, and then we implement to the our image like this. For example, this is the binary image from the transfer process, and we want to get the larger, so we use the dilation. And if we want our image is smaller, we use the erosion. This is the object within the black object within the white object. If we want to close these two objects within it, we can use the opening, closing, and also opening. So this object, this is similar to this one, but without the object within it like this. This is the closing operation, and this one is the opening operation. So this object, the smaller one, and this is the white one, and then we divide these two objects using the opening operation. So in some cases, the morphological operation should be used to get our desired result. The third one in the image processing is the geometrical transformation. So the geometrical transformation are sometimes needed to solve the specific problem or to get our intended result. The very simplest one is rigid geometrical transformation using the translation or rotation. This is, for example, the original image. If we use the geometrical transformation, we can use the translation like this. We can see here that the object is moved to the right position. Or we using the rotation like this, the object will rotate it with the specific angles like this. And the second one of the geometrical transformation is the affine geometrical transformation. The affine transformation meaning that the rigid transformation plus scaling or skewing like this. This one, this is the original image, and then we move the object from one position to another, and then we scale out, so we get the wider object like this, or maybe we skew this object like this. In some cases, it is not enough only using affine transformation. In some cases, we should use the curve geometrical transformation, meaning that the nonlinear deformation is used. This is, for example, in the if we want to combine one image, two images at another position, maybe in one time to another, so the image is not in rigid position, but this is deformation in our image. So to registration, we should use the curve geometrical transformation. But basically, this process is relatively difficult to do. And another topics in the image analysis or image processing is interpolation. The image interpolation also sometimes needed. For example, in the image reconstruction like this, if we have the axial image and we want to get the sagittal or coronal images, so we reconstruct our images. But sometimes the pixel size in the Y, in the in the X, Y, and Z axis is different. So if we only arrange our image, maybe the our image is non-isotropics. To get our image in the isotropic ways, we should use the interpolation. This is the example. We add the many pixel between the another pixel. Now, this is the interpolation. The interpolation sometimes in one dimension, in two dimension, and in some cases we need the 3D interpolation. And in the image processing, the process of convolution is usually and sometimes needed also. For example, to get the filtering and to sharp our image, to show the edge of the image, we use the convolution. Basically, the convolution, this is the original image, and then we have the windows, sliding window with the for example, in this example is 3x3, and we use the kernel, and the different kernel will produce the different process. For example, this is the kernel for getting the average, so for sharpening, for X-ray derivative, and so on. So after the convolution, we get our intended image like this. So the convolution is very crucial in the image processing. And the inverse, the convolution is the deconvolution. This is the example, the image, and we convolve this image with this PSF, point spread function. This is the convolution. So we can see here that after the convolution, our image is blurred. So basically, in our image, in CT scan or in PET scan or in MRI, our image is corrupted by the PSF, point spread function. The question is, can we remove the blur in our image? Of course, by using the deconvolution. If we know our PSF, point spread function, and then we can use the deconvolution to make our image sharp again. This is the example of the image, and this is the original image before deconvolution, and this one is the image after the convolution. The image, the spatial resolution of the image is getting better like this. And another process very important in the image processing is the Fourier transformation. The Fourier transformation is to transform the image from the spatial domain to the frequency domain. In the frequency domain, sometimes the process is very faster and easier than in the spatial domain. For example, in the image reconstruction, this is the projection data, the sinogram, and this is the filter. Before we using the back projection, we filter our image first using the convolution kernel. This can be done in the spatial domain, but it is rather difficult. It is easier to do the filtering in the frequency domain. Of course, to transform from the spatial domain to the frequency domain, we use the Fourier transformation. And after that, after the filtering, and we get back our image using the inverse Fourier transformation. And actually, in the image processing, there are so many transformations another than Fourier transformation. For example, the half transformation, for example, the radon transformation, inverse radon transformation, and so on. The half transformation is usually used to detect the angle of the object. And this is sometimes used in the image processing. Okay. And we move to the second topic of our talk today about the parameters of the CT image quality. Yeah, CT, of course, is the excellent tool for modern clinical medical imaging. And CT, it is maybe available in almost all hospitals throughout the world. Yeah. And CT is improved day by day. This is the example of the image of the early CT. It's very, the pixel only about 80 by 80, and the depth only N3, meaning that the gray scale is only 8 from the dark one to the white one. And this is one of the image of the modern city. So in the modern city, the image is better in terms of the noise, in terms of the spatial resolution, in terms of the absence of the artifact, and so on. And this is the evolution of the city. Yeah. This is the axial city, move to the spiral city, move to the city with TCM tube current modulation, move to the multi-detector city. And in the last decade, we heard about the war of slice, okay, MDCT. And then move to the city with IR, iterative reconstruction, and then move to the dual source city, DSCT. At beginning, the DSCT, the dual source CT, is intended to make the faster of scanning. But after that, the scientists understand that the using the two source of the CT, it is important not only to make the scanning is faster, but using the different energy of the CT, meaning that the different GV will have the very interesting result. So after this, we move to the DECT, dual energy CT. And by using the dual energy CT, we can decompose the object with the different, with the similar CT number. For example, after introduction of the DECT, the contrast agent and the bone can be separated like this. This is the useful of the DECT. And after that, move to the MECT, multi-energy CT, and called as the PCCT, photon counting CT. And of course, after the introduction of the deep learning or AI, the deep learning CT also introduced. So this is the evolution of the CT until now. The parameters of image quality, so many parameters, but the key parameters is the accuracy of the CT number, the image noise, spatial resolution, low contrast detectability, absence of the artifact. But the other parameters also affecting the image quality, such as the slightness, lesser alignment, can retell, and so on. And of course, to measure the image quality, we use the phantom. There are so many phantoms, such as the APM CT performance phantom, OCR phantom, and CatFan phantom. Okay, this is the modules in the OCR phantom. Basically, there are 4 modules. This is the module for measuring the slice thickness, for measuring the accuracy CT number of many objects. This is the homogeneous module for measuring the homogeneity or uniformity, and so on. This is the low object module for measuring the low contrast. And this is the line pair for measuring the spatial resolution. This is the images of the SCR phantom. This is the another type of phantom, CatFan phantom. The intention is similar, but the design and the object within the phantom is different. This is the axial images of the Catfan phantom. This is the APMC, the performance phantom, and this is the also medullary object within the APMC, the performance phantom. This is the example of images of the APMC, the performance phantom. Okay, like this. This is, we can also measure the image quality using manufacturer's phantom, such as the Siemens phantom, Philips phantom, GE phantom, Toshiba phantom, and so on. Basically, the manufacturer also supply the phantom for measuring the image quality. Fortunately, the image quality can also be measured from the clinical CT images. This is the example of measuring the noise of the image, of the clinical CT image, directly and automatically from the image of the patient. This is using the technique, the name is the using the convolution. And this one is the map of the SD map, standard deviation map. So we measure the standard deviation in all pixels, and then we get the SD map. And after getting this map, we make the histogram of the SD map, and we can, and this histogram of the map of the SD, and the maximum values, maximum frequency, and the x-axis will be the GNI, global noise index. This is the example of measuring the image quality directly from the patient images. Okay, we move to the last topic, some example of the automatic CT image quality assessment. Yeah, because in the limited time, I only discuss about measuring slice thickness on the APMCT performance phantom and the Catfan phantom. And if you want to more understand about this technique, you can see my paper published in the Journal of Applied Clinical Medical Physics. And this is the image, the photograph of the APM phantom. And this one is the image of the module for measuring the slice thickness, like this. To measure the slice thickness, we can simply using the ruler or caliper to measure the width this object, like this. Also, we can use the profile. If we use the profile from this position to this one, we get the profile of this object. And after this, we can measure the full width at half maximum. This full width of half maximum indicate the slice thickness of the image. For the automatic measurement, there are two challenges. The first one, how to detect the center of the object, of the star object. And the second one, how to detect the angles of the star object. This is the two challenges if we want to measure the slice thickness automatically. This is the example of wrong detection of the object center. This is good result. This is the wrong result. This is the wrong result, this one. This is the wrong result. And this one, and this is good. This is the example of the wrong detection of the star object angle. Basically, the detection of the center object is right, but the angle is wrong, like this. This one is wrong, this one is wrong, this one is wrong. We want the angle like this. And how to determine the center of object and how to determine automatically and accurately the angle of the our profile. So this is the process to detect the object, the center of the object, and also the angle of the object. This is the original image. In this one, we're using the threshold process. In this example, we use maybe around 100 consular unit, because this object is from the aluminum with the pixel values more than 100. So by using 100 threshold, we can get this object. And after this, we want to only take one object. So to do that, we use the labeling process. We label this one, and this one is label 1, label 2, label 3. And in this example, we only get the object with label 2. And after that, we measure the center of the object by using the centroid equation. And this is the example. We get the centroid of the object. This is the accurate position of the centroid of the object. And after that, we want to get the angles. So to get the angles, and then we crop this object like this. And after that, we apply the half transformation. The half transformation basically is similar to the Radon transformation, and meaning this is the projection from the different angles. The result of the half transformation of this object is like this. We can see here that the angle of this object is in this position, but we want to detect automatically this position. So we transform from the gray level to the digital one, to the only white and black one. So we transform to this one. And after that, we sum up to the Y axis, and we get the one dimension of the half transformation. And from this graph, it is very, very, very easy to detect the minimum position of the half transformation. And this minimum values indicate the angles of the object. This is very, basically it's very simple. After getting the angles of the object, and then we crop again the original object, and then we rotate using the rotation based on the angle detected from the half transformation. This is the rotated object. And after that, we crop again so that we only get the stair object. After that, we sum up to the x-axis, and we get this profile. And after this, it is very simple to measure the full width at half maximum. This is the algorithm how to detect and measure the slice thickness of the image automatically from the AFM phantom. This is our result with the different slice thickness from 1 millimeters to 5 millimeters, like this. This is the profile with their full width at half maximums. Okay, this is another type. Yeah. As already discussed, the object will rotate it. Maybe in the rotation, and the image will be a little bit large. So it is important to get the full width at half maximum without rotation of the object. Basically, it is also very easy to do. After we get the angles from the half transformation, and we detect the center of the object, and then we draw lines. We draw line with our detected angles like this. This is the example how to draw the line perpendicular to the object, and we get also the profile of the object like this. This is the result with the rotational technique and non-rotational technique. Basically, the result is very similar. Okay, this is another example. Automatically measure the slice thickness on the cat fan phantom. Okay, this is the example of the captain phantom. The object for measuring the slice thickness is different from the AAPM phantom. This is the types of the captain phantom, 1, 2, and 3. But for measuring the slice thickness is similar. But we can see here that in this module, there are so many objects, not only for measuring the slice thickness, but also for measuring the CT number, for measuring the distance, for measuring the MTF, and so on. So if we only use the threshold technique, maybe it is very difficult to get accurately the object for measuring the slice thickness. So in this scenario, we use the technique like this. So the first, this is the original image of the CT, and we detect the object like this, and then we detect the center of this object, and then we use the circular with diameter only half of this object, so we can get like this. And by using this circular, we make the as the mask to get the object in this, only in this area. So by using this technique, we have removed the many object for measuring the CT number, linearity, and so on. So by using this technique, after that we use the threshold technique. So by using this technique, we only get the object for measuring slice thickness, and this is the object for measuring the MTF. And after that, we using the technique to detect the properties of this object by using circularity and so on. So by using the circularity, we can remove the point for measuring MTF, and we get only the object for measuring the slice thickness. And after that, we using the half transformation to detect the angle. And after that, we drew the line, and we get the profile to measure the slice thickness. This is the example for measuring the slice thickness on the cat fan phantom. This is the example for the result of measuring slice thickness on the cat fan phantom. Okay, this is the result from the different slice thickness. But maybe we can think that using the half transformation, it is only accurate for the wide slice thickness. But for the thin slice thickness, maybe the technique is not accurate. Okay, so in this occasion, we introduce the new technique how to detect the angle without the half transformation, but we use this point for measuring the distance as the reference to detect the angle. By using this technique, the angle is more accurate compared to the using the half transformation. This is the result. Even by using the half transformation, the wide slice thickness is not so accurate like this. But by using the different object as the reference, the result is more accurate. Okay, this is the and the techniques is already integrated to this software, the IndoQCT, and you can also download this software in this link, www.indoqct.com/IndoQCT. And after you after downloading on the software, you can you should activate the software using this ID and key. This is the example of the graphical user interface of the IndoQCT. And in this occasion, I will show you how to measure the slice thickness automatically on the phantom already discussed. Okay, in this example, I will show you the how to measure the slice thickness on the AABM phantom. Okay, this is the example of the AABM CT image. To measure the slice thickness, we use this step, slice thickness like this. And there is the option method, automatic or manual. In this occasion, we choose the automatic option, rotation or no rotation. In this example, we choose the rotation. Threshold, dynamic or static, we choose the dynamic. The stair, using stair the top button or average. In this example, maybe we choose the middle like this, and then we click the calculate. And the software will automatically detect the object, and this is the object in the middle, and this one is the object is rotated, and this one is the image is cropped, and this one is the profile with full width at half maximum. Indicate the slice thickness of the object. I will try another one. If we choose this one, the no rotation, and then calculate, then we get the result like this. This is the line to get the profile of the stair object in the middle position. If we, for example, change to the average, meaning that the three stair object will automatically detect it like this. This is the example of measuring the slice thickness on the AABM phantom. This is another example for measuring the slice thickness on the cat fan phantom. And this one, for example, the object for measuring the slice thickness. This is the phantom, should be the cat fan phantom. And then we just click calculate. And we get the detect the object to measure the slice thickness, and then we get the profile, and then we automatically obtain the full width at half maximum, indicating the slice thickness. Okay, you can try this in your computer. Okay, I think that's all from me. Thank you very much, and assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Choirul Anam, for your enlightening talk. And I think that we'd like to open the floor for the question. And if you have any queries about this, please feel free to unmute your mic and ask the question, or alternatively, you can use the chat box or Q&A features. The Webex feature, and please get your chance to engage with our distinguished speaker and get more information about the digital image processing in radiology and nuclear medicine. And I think we can start our discussion now. And also, for all participants, please fill in the attendance form for e-certificate at the chat box. And at the same time, for USM staff, you need to fill in. You need to fill in the QR code. This is for USM staff and for undergraduate student only. Okay. And for everybody, for other candidates, and all candidates, you need to fill in the attendance form for. It's for e-certificate for you. Okay. And let us hear any question from the participant. Yeah, bisa aja nanya terus-terusan. Mungkin saya mau tanya dengan Dr. Anam berkenaan dengan the software. So I wanted to know in which platform that you wrote your software. Is it in C++ or MATLAB?
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Zahri. Thank you very much. The platform for developing the IndoQCT is Python software.
Okay.
Yeah, Python. But unfortunately, until now, the IndoQCT is only run in the Windows operating system. Yeah.
Okay.
And this is the limitation. Of the IndoQCT now, yeah. Maybe in the next we will extend so the IndoQCT can also run in the Mac system or another system.
And what is the type of image that you use? Is this that you process the image? Is it in DICOM or is it in JPEG or TIFF?
Yeah. Because this is for measuring the image quality, so the image should be in the original type of the image quality, of the type of the medical image quality, medical. So the type of the image should be in the DICOM, yeah, okay. Only in the DICOM. So the IndoQCT cannot measure the image from the JPEG or another type of the image.
Yeah, I think that is good because I seen some of the papers that is usually from computer science background. They use to process all the image from JPEG, probably. I think it is not very objective to the medical image. Purpose.
Yeah.
I agree with you. Okay, any other question from others? Also, Dr. Syahir, maybe. Okay, I have a question from Mustafa Al Haji Barbi. Is there any limitation using MATLAB in programming the software in image processing? I think this question is for Dr. Anna, maybe.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Barbi. Basically, the MATLAB is very good software. And we can also get the very accurate result using the MATLAB. But in my opinion, but unfortunately, the MATLAB is not good for distribution of the software. It is good for measuring something, but it is not good for distribution. So if we want, our software can be downloaded by someone, can be installed easily, so the MATLAB is not good in my opinion.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. At the beginning, I developed the software in the MATLAB, but after know this fact, and then we move to the Python. The Python is very powerful, both in the accuracy and also the for easiest to the distribution. And also for the fast calculation.
I think thank you. I think that is, yeah. Thank you very much for Mustafa. think you already answered this question. So, any other question from the floor? Maybe we can take another one or two questions.
Hello, assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullah.
Saya mau bertanya satu pertanyaan saja, Pak Anam.
Ya, bisa, bisa.
So after we have the presentation for measuring the image quality in subquantum image, what is the prospect of measuring the quality from the patient image? Yeah. Any comment on this?
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Aris. The measuring the image quality from the phantom, it is important for the quality control purposes. But for the optimization, it is not enough measuring the image quality from the phantom. It should measure the image quality from the image of the patient. So the measuring automatic method for the image quality from the clinical image of the patient is very, very promising in the future to do the optimization of the of the image quality and dose of the received by the patient. So the measurement from the phantom good for the quality control, but not good for the optimization. But measuring the image quality from the image from the clinical image good for the optimization, but not good for the image from the quality control. So this is the why we should develop the software. Both for measuring the image from the phantom and also measuring from the patient clinical image, like that.
And I also have probably the last question from the participant to Dr. Syahir. Could you explain a little bit about EOF parameter? Can it affect the signal detectability in PET?
Yes, assalamualaikum. The question is that you want to know more about the time of flight. So basically the time of flight they measure within an area within the picosecond timing resolution. So basically, what is mean by time of flight? So time, it's actually time of arrival between, because just now, as I mentioned, we have a pair of annihilation photon, right? So from there, basically the detectors, one detector shall detect the arrival time of the photons. So basically, with the information of the arrival time, we basically can tell which point, or you can reduce the probability of the annihilation area within certain area of the line of response. Basically, if you don't have the time of flight information, the probability can be along the line of response. But if you have basically the time of flight information, you basically can pinpoint from where the annihilation photon came from. Yeah. I hope it's helped. Yeah.
Okay. I think that is sufficient for now. I would like to thank to both speakers for today, Dr. Syahir and Dr. Anam, for their very excellent talk for today. And I would like to pass this session back to Dr. Aimi. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Zahri. I would just to remind again for the participants from USM to click on the attendance link. And for others, they will have, there is a link in the chat box to fill in the attendance form for the e-certificate as well. Apart from that, I think we have come to the end of the program. And we would like to thank everyone, all participants, the speakers, the moderator, and also the VIPs for your presence and support for this program. And before we end, can I just ask everyone to turn on their videos for us to have a picture session, if that's okay?
Okay, ready everyone? Okay, for the first page, is mine. Okay, wait. Okay, now we go to second page. Okay, just mine. Okay, next page. Okay, that's all.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you so much everyone for your participation in the second IPPT-USM-UNDIP joint webinar. We hope that you find the webinar informative and of benefit to you and your practice. Have a great day and a wonderful afternoon. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you. Thank you everyone.
Yeah. Thank you semuanya. Terima kasih, Dr. Zahri.
Terima kasih.
Diana, ya.
Ya.
Sampai ketemu di lain kesempatan, insya Allah.
Terima kasih, Mas. Halo, Mas Anam. Terima kasih.
Ya, ya.
Terima kasih semuanya.
Terima kasih.